Well, if you got your Bible with you, let's take it and turn to the book of Hebrews. We're returning to our ongoing study of the book of Hebrews. A couple of weeks ago, we finished Hebrews chapter 7, and now we are turning the corner into Hebrews chapter 8. And just like chapter 7, chapter 8 will be quite meaty as well. Many of you said that. The writer of Hebrews actually says that. He wanted to give you, or the readers, milk back in chapter, or he wanted to give you the meat back in chapter 5, but he had to start out with milk. But he ultimately got to the meat, and the meat was in chapter 7, and it's going to continue here in 8, even 9 and 10. But we're parked here at chapter 8. Let me just read it for us. It's only 13 verses. Hebrews chapter 8. Now, the main point of what is being said is this. We have this kind of high priest who sat down at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and the true tabernacle that was set up by the Lord and not man. For every high priest is appointed to offer gifts and sacrifices. Therefore, it was necessary for this priest also to have something to offer. Now, if he were on earth, he wouldn't be a priest, since there are those offerings, the gifts prescribed by the laws. These serve as a copy and shadow of the heavenly things, as Moses was warned when he was about to complete the tabernacle. For God said, "Be careful that you make everything according to the pattern that was shown to you on the mountain." But Jesus has now obtained a superior ministry, and to that degree, he is the mediator of a better covenant, which has been established on better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, there would have been no occasion for a second one. But finding fault with his people, he says, "See, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not like the covenant that I made with their ancestors on the day I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. I showed no concern for them, says the Lord, because they did not continue in my covenant. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws into their minds and write them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. And each person will not teach his fellow citizen, and each his brother or sister, saying, 'Know the Lord,' because they will all know me, from the least to the greatest of them. For I will forgive their wrongdoing, and I will never again remember their sins." By saying a new covenant, he has declared that the first is obsolete, and what is obsolete and growing old is about to pass away. And the Lord bless the reading of his word. Now, if you were with us the last few weeks, we learned in chapter 7, and we'll continue to learn it in chapter 8, that Jesus Christ is God's superior high priest. He's more superior than Melchizedek, and with that, he's more superior than Aaron. But a question might arise, is there anything that can minimize this superiority? I mean, as a person, yes, Jesus is more superior, but what about his work? What about his work? Is his work more superior as well? In other words, is his work sufficient? We're not casting any question upon his person, but what about his work? As a priest, he has work. He ministers. Is that sufficient as well? Well, all of that to say is basically the next three chapters answers that particular question. What we'll see is that our high priest, Jesus, ministers on the basis of a better covenant. That's chapter 8. Also, Jesus ministers in a better sanctuary. That's the heart of chapter 9. And then when you come into chapter 10, Jesus ministers with a better sacrifice. So Jesus is a more superior high priest, but he, with being the mediator of a new covenant, means that his work will be sufficient. And is sufficient, did we just lose sound? Sounds like we lost sound. Or maybe I don't hear myself. Anyway, Jesus ministers on the basis of a better covenant, a better sanctuary, and obviously with a better sacrifice, because the sacrifice ultimately is what? Himself. Not blood of bulls and goats, but with his own blood. So that's the next three chapters as we begin chapter 8, just so you have the heads up. A better covenant, a better sanctuary, and a better sacrifice. Now, as I said a moment ago, this is all meat. And you might think it's all academic. This is a lot of information that's passed on from the writer to his readers, and it's the information that they need to know that Jesus' superiority outweighs than any priest of the Levitical system, and his sacrifice is more superior than any of the Levitical sacrifices. But he's not given all of this information to his readers just as an academic exercise. You cannot read it that way. Yes, this is all theological, if not Christological. This is all doctrinal. But there is a particular purpose with all this. There is a singular goal why he gives you all of this information on Christ's person and ultimately all of Christ's work. And you can see the purpose there in verse 1. Look at verse 1. Now, he says, the main point of what is being said is this. Isn't that good? I mean, he's been going for seven chapters. If you haven't gotten it yet, here it is. Here is the main point. And what is it? We have this kind of high priest who sat down at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. Now, I checked most translations, and the bulk of them have the main point. I think that's what you have there in your translation. Certainly, I'm reading the Christian Standard Bible here, and it has the main point. Commentators are a bit divided on how to understand what it means by the main point. Some of the older commentaries take it as, this is a summary. I mean, he's getting to chapter 8, he looks back at 1 through 7, and just to make sure all the readers are with him, let me summarize, basically is what he's saying here. Just to make sure everyone is following me, let me summarize here everything that I've argued from chapter 1, even particularly chapter 5, in order to prove and persuade that Jesus is more superior. If you didn't get it by now, here it is. Our high priest sat down in the place of highest honor in heaven at God's right hand. Now, in many ways, this is not a hill to die on. You can understand it by way of summary. But I think there's a better way of understanding it. The main point, as he says here, is not pointing to a summary of arguments so far, but he's actually making the main point of the book as a whole. In other words, not just what came before, but also what comes after. In other words, if you're going to take all 13 chapters of the book of Hebrews and you're going to summarize what he's trying to say in one main point, here it is. This is the main point of the whole book of the Hebrews. And what is that? What is the main point of Hebrews? Which, by the way, is ultimately the main point of the Gospels, the main point of Christianity. And here it is. It's all about Jesus, of course. But particularly, it's about him being a what? What have we been talking about? What it actually says here in verse 1? That Jesus is, in a word, a king priest. Remember that? I mean, everything he says that in a soundbite there in verse 1, it comes up with Jesus is a king priest. For these Jewish Christians who are reading this for the first time, that's good news. That's the gospel. Especially when you understand all of what it means. What does it mean that Jesus is a king priest? Well, he's explaining all of that. Jesus is a king priest. And as he says here, that is the main point of Hebrews. So if you've been sleeping all the way from chapter 1 to chapter 7, and you're going to fall asleep again after chapter 8, verse 2, make sure you understand that the book of Hebrews, in one soundbite, one verse, is Jesus is a king priest. Now, as we said before, there were kings in the Old Testament and there were priests in the Old Testament, but there was never a king priest in one person. at least in the state of Israel, nation of Israel. I guess you, as we said earlier, you can go back to Adam. Adam was a king priest. Noah was a king priest. Melchizedek was a king priest, and this is why Jesus is a king priest according to the order of Melchizedek. But when the nation of Israel was established, that's when it kind of just veered off to kings, priests, and prophets. But when you come then to Jesus, Jesus brings all three of those offices back together, being the last Adam. The first Adam was a king, prophet, priest. Jesus, too, is a prophet, priest, and king. But in particular here, he's emphasizing that Jesus is a king, priest. Again, you notice verse 1. We have this kind of high priest, okay, he's a priest, who sat down at the right hand of the throne, that sounds like a king, of the majesty in the heavens. So there you go, in that one verse, put it together in one word, Jesus is a king priest. Now, of course you could say, if you've been tracking with us, that the main point of the book of Hebrews is don't fall away, right? He sees in this group of Jewish Christians, he does believe that they're Christians, but they're dull, they're apathetic, they're immature, they're backsliding at best and at worst, they seem to be apostatizing, and so he's picked up his pen to write this to motivate them not to fall away, but to press forward. So in that sense, you could say that the main point of the book of Hebrews, the reason why he wrote it is for them not to fall away. But what you have here in verse 1 then is what? The main theological point that undergirds that command. Don't fall away. Why? Because Jesus is a king priest. And you need a king priest. I mean, why would you fall away knowing who Jesus is? Why would you return to Judaism? Why would you abandon Christ? Or as we put it a couple weeks ago, if you do walk away, who then is going to atone for your sins? Remember, this is the issue. The blood of bulls and goats doesn't take away sin. You go back to Judaism. You go back to those Levitical priests and Levitical sacrifices. They were all temporary. And then, yeah, sure, there was an atonement, but it was a temporary atonement. There was forgiveness, but there was temporary forgiveness. But you need something that's sufficient and perfect, eternal. And this is what he's trying to argue. This is the main point. The main point is that Jesus is the king priest. And he's the only one that's going to deal with your sins. So all of that to say is that for these readers, you can tell that there's something wrong here. And the problem is particularly spiritual. I mean, you got to understand that. I mean, for all the theological arguments about the person and the work of Christ throughout the book of Hebrews, and as we said, this is all meat. We're in a theology class here. But the underlying issue of these Hebrews that put them on the verge of apostasy was their spirituality, or lack thereof. As I said, as you kind of pull out of different parts of the book of Hebrews, you can tell that they're lazy, they're dull, they're undiscerning, and simply just immature. So what do you give them? How many times have I said that the book of Hebrews is really a good book for biblical counselors? You know somebody that's lazy, dull, undiscerning, and simply immature, that's kind of struggling with life? What do you say to them? You come alongside and point them to who? You point them to Christ, and you talk about who Christ is. You point to them, point them to him as the king, as the priest. In other words, what they needed was a good dose of theology. I mean, I find that amazing. For all the discussions that you hear out there in churches that, don't give us theology, don't give us anything doctrinal, we want to be inspired. You hear that, right? Maybe some of you have been in churches like that. We just want to be inspired. Give us a good story. Help us. And you see this on TV, right? Just motivate us. And it's like Tony Robbins with a few Bible verses tacked on. And I always said, I could get up here and I could inspire you. I could tell a bunch of stories. I could tell you my own stories. I could make it all about me. And I could probably boost you up on the psychological ladder a few rings. And you might walk out of the door feeling pretty good. But by the time you get in the car, drive around the corner, guess what? That feeling's going to be gone. It's not about inspiration, it's about transformation. It's about being changed. It's not about you being knocked up one level on the psychological rings. It's about you moving yourself one level of glory to the next, conforming yourself to the image of Christ. And this is what the Word of God does. This is what theology does. So yes, the problem is spiritual, but the solution is theological. It's doctrinal. And again, it's no different today. I mean, what you have with these folks, we could say it about the church today. You look at it. You look at your own life, and you ask why so many Christians are just like these folks. Lazy, undiscerning, immature. I mean, it's a spiritual issue, but we know the solution. The solution is theological. Now, of course, it's not just getting all the information. It's not about all that. It's about applying all the information. So faith is the issue, and he makes that a big point, right, in the early chapters. Faith is the necessary element that needs to be, what's the word he used? Mixed. Remember that back in Hebrews 4:2? Remember, he keeps comparing them to the Hebrews of the Exodus. That's why the book's called the Hebrews. He says, don't be like them. Don't be like those Hebrews that left Egypt, crossed the Red Sea, saw all the miracles, and then what? And we just read it in Hebrews 8. They abandon God, and God abandons them. Because they didn't have faith. They didn't trust. They didn't believe. So, if you understand what he's doing here, he's presenting, explaining, teaching the truth of the gospel. He's telling them, he's telling us who Christ is and his person and his work. But all of that to say is that the root issue here for these readers is spiritual. It's spirituality. And as we've pointed out a number of times, and you see this throughout the book of Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews actually defines spirituality as access to God. I don't know how you define spirituality, but the writer of Hebrews basically says, if you are spiritual, someone that is defined as spiritual is someone who communes with God. I actually like that. Someone who communes with God. I mean, you go back to chapter 7, look at verse 19, just to point you to a couple places where he says this. What does he say there in verse 19 of chapter 7? A better hope is introduced through which we what? Draw near to God. That's the goal. The goal is that you would draw near to God. Go over a couple chapters to chapter 10. This is probably the most explicit of all the verses that mention this. Look at verse 19. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have boldness to enter the sanctuary through the blood of Jesus, he is inaugurated for us a new and living way through the curtain, that is through his flesh. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, do what? Verse 22. Let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed in pure water. Why is he telling us all about the superiority of Jesus Christ? Because he wants you to have communion with God. And you can't have communion with God without Jesus Christ. You can only have communion with God with a mediator. There's one God and one man and one mediator, the man Christ Jesus. And in a sense, you come back to chapter 8, verse 1, this is the main point. This is the main point. This is in fact, you can say this is the main goal of the gospel. God saves sinners. Why? Because he seeks who? He seeks true worshipers. Man left on his own. Man left in his sin. Not interested in God. We've all been there. All before we came to Christ. We weren't interested in God. We were interested in doing our own thing and pursuing the world and its pleasures. As we know, we were hopeless, left in the dark. But God, right? But God, he came and he saved us. And the whole point of salvation is to go back to what the catechism first question says, is to enjoy God and glorify him forever. That sounds like communion, right? The goal of salvation is communion with God. And again, I don't know what you think of Christians or what Christianity is, but that's what we do. We worship individually, and then we come together on a Sunday and we worship corporately. Worship, communion, that's the goal of salvation. And as I said, you need a mediator for that. You actually need a king priest for that. Hence why there's so much attention on Jesus here. And now, as I said, when you come into chapter 8, the attention is shifted a bit onto the new covenant. Because Jesus is a mediator, but he's a mediator of a covenant, but he's a mediator of a new covenant. Now, the old covenant didn't bring perfection when it came to communion. There was communion. We read a little bit about it in Exodus 25 a moment ago, and I do want us to go back there just so you can see it by way of contrast with the new covenant. God did provide a way in the old covenant, but it wasn't perfect. In fact, the only communion was the priest. Only the priests went into the Holy of Holies. All you did was get to the outer courtyard, as it were, to bring your sacrifice. The old priesthood didn't bring you into the presence of God. The old covenant didn't bring perfection into that communion. So what's the point? The point is that you need a new priesthood, and you, with that, need a new covenant. Is everybody with me so far? I'm just trying to summarize before we drop down onto the pages, just to give you the big picture here. In fact, let's move to that. Because what you find here in chapter 8, again, we're talking about the superiority of Jesus and the superiority of the new covenant. And what he's going to walk you through here in chapter 8 is four arguments, or maybe you could say four evidences, for the superiority of the new covenant. He's already argued from chapter 5 to chapter 7, and in a sense will continue through 8, 9, and 10, the superiority of Jesus Christ. But he's just kind of drifting your eyes over to the new covenant at this point. And he's saying that this new covenant is more superior than the old covenant. And he's going to give you some reasons why. Let me give you the four reasons up front, and then we'll work our way through them. We're probably going to get to two this morning. But if you are taking notes, the new covenant is more superior to the old covenant. Why? Number one, because it is ministered by a better mediator. You catch that? Obviously, we know who that is. That's just verse one. The new covenant is more superior to the old covenant because it is ministered by a better mediator. Secondly, it's better, more superior, because it's ministered in a better place. That's verse two. The priests all ministered where? In an earthly sanctuary, tabernacle, temple. Where does Jesus minister? Verse 2, he ministers where? Well, in a better sanctuary, in a better place, which is where? Heaven. That sounds better. Reason number three, evidence number three, the new covenant is more superior to the old covenant because it is ministered with a better sacrifice. That brings us to verses 3 through 5. And of course, it's a better sacrifice because it's a sacrifice of him. It's not the sacrifice of bulls and goats. The blood of bulls and goats, again, was just a temporary expiation, a temporary propitiation. It allowed God to dwell with his people because God was a holy God dwelling amongst an unholy people. But again, it was just a shadow. It was temporary. They needed something more perfect, more eternal. A sacrifice for sin. Sin brings death. The wages of sin is death. All of us are sinners. All of us deserve to die. So either we die or somebody dies in our place. And this is the grace of God and the goodness of God, that he's provided a substitute. He's provided a substitute in his son. So guess what his son did? He died in our place. That's the better sacrifice. And then finally, we'll come back to that. But finally, point number four, the new covenant is more superior to the old covenant because it is ministered on better promises. The new covenant comes with better promises, particularly what? Your sins are forgiven. How about that? your sins are forgiven. Have you ever evangelized that way? You go up to a person, how would you like your sins forgiven? But that's what you get with the new covenant. Again, all of those 4 points, it is ministered by a better mediator, it is ministered in a better place, it is ministered with a better sacrifice, it is ministered on better promises. All of that point to the main point, which is what? You get to have communion with God. You get to have peace with God. I mean, just to put it in our context, I mean, if you're wondering why you are spiritually dry, lacking joy in your life, little or no power overcoming sin, I guess the question we could ask to begin with, well, what's your communion with God like? What's your communion with God like? I mean, David, if you go back to the Psalms, David understood the connection between his joy and God's presence. He understood that when you're communing with God, there is joy. Remember Psalm 16:11? In your presence is what? Abundant joy, and at your right hand are eternal pleasures. I love that verse. In the presence of God, you're not, you're not going to be gloomy. In the presence of God, you're not going to just be full of apathy. When you understand the glory of God, in your presence, David says, is abundant joy. He says something similar in Psalm 21:6. You give him blessings forever, talking about man. You cheer him with joy in your presence. Joy, inexpressible joy. I've been meditating on Psalm 40 the last few weeks. I won't read just the whole psalm, but just a few verses here that speaks to the same theme. I waited patiently, this is David, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he turned to me and heard my cry for help. He brought me up from a desolate pit out of the muddy clay and set my feet on a rock, making my steps secure. So you see he went from bad to good, in a sense. He didn't, not necessarily change the circumstances, but it changed the internal attitudes. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear, and they will trust in the Lord. And in verse 4, I love this. How happy, you could send an hymn for joy, how happy is anyone who has put his trust in the Lord. Circle back to, it's a faith issue. Sure, it's a theological issue, but it's a faith issue as well. The Apostle Paul understood this as well. Romans 15:13. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you believe, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Obviously, you need the Holy Spirit, but in the means of grace, you must believe. And when you believe, what? You're filled with all joy and peace and hope. That's the promise to the Christian. But you must discipline yourself towards that, right? J.C. Ryle, we're all familiar with him. J.C. Ryle in 1879 wrote this, "Regular and habitual communion with the Lord Jesus is absolutely essential to growth in grace. I mean that daily habit of communion between the believer and his Savior, which can only be carried on by faith, prayer, and meditation. It is a habit, I fear, of which many believers know little." He wrote that in 1879, could read it today. "It is possible to have union with Christ and yet have little communion with him." Communion between the bridegroom and his bride, between the head and his members, between the physician and his patients, between the advocate and his clients, between the shepherd and his sheep, between the master and his scholars. Communion, he says, implies a habit of daily application for things needed and of daily pouring out and unburdening our hearts and minds. It is getting close to him and laying on him with confidence as a loving personal friend. Now, I believe that no man will ever grow in grace who does not know something experimentally of the habit of communion. We must seek to have personal intimacy with the Lord Jesus. and to deal with him as a man deals with a loving friend. We must realize that what it is to turn to him first in every need, to talk to him about every difficulty, to consult with him about every step, to spread before him all our sorrows, to get to him, to share in all our joys, to do all as in his sight, and to go through every day leaning on and looking to him, end quote. I mean, that's the message of Hebrews. Look to him, consider him. Again, you find yourself backsliding, falling away. How's your communion with God? How's your communion with Christ? This is the main point. The main point of Hebrews, which is the main point of the gospel and the main point of salvation, is that you have peace with the living God and commune with him all day long. And in order to do that, we must what? We must have a better high priest. A king priest at that. We must have a better sanctuary. We must have a better sacrifice. We must have a better covenant with better promises. Notice, better, better, better. Everything's better now because of what God has done in Christ. Again, remember everything in the old covenant, with its priesthood, with its sacrifices, with its temple. What does he say down there in verse 13? Look at the last verse. He says that all, what? It's obsolete. It's growing old. It's passing away. I mean, obviously, I think that points to the fact that this letter was written before 70 AD, because in 70 AD, remember, the Romans came in and toppled the temple down so they couldn't have sacrifices anymore. And I think the writer of Hebrews knew that was coming. You're going back to Judaism? Why? There's nothing to go back to. It's about to die. It's passing away. It's obsolete now. Something new is here. Something better is here. Again, this is the main point. You get access to God through Jesus Christ. You get to have communion with God yourself. You get forgiveness of sins. This is all in the new covenant. And by the way, you notice, we won't get there today, but you notice from verse 8 all the way down to verse 12, in most Bibles it's highlighted, indented. It's a quote. He's cut and pasted Jeremiah 31, and Jeremiah 31 is where he has prophesied through Jeremiah that the new covenant was coming. So he has to go back there and say that the new covenant is far more superior than the old covenant. And as I said, the writer here presents four reasons, four evidence for that superiority. So let's walk through them. And at this point, we're probably going to get point number one. Here's the first evidence for the superiority of this new covenant. Everybody with me? As I said, I just wanted to give you the gist, the big picture before we land. I trust you're getting it. But let's look specifically what he says here. Again, the first evidence for the superiority of this new covenant is, number one, it is ministered by a better mediator. And that's just verse one. Now, the main point of what is being said is this: we have this kind of high priest who sat down at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. That he's talking about Christ. He's talking about this new covenant that's better. And with this new covenant comes a better mediator. And if you want to break it down, you'll notice that this better mediator is better because of his perfect sufficiency. Let's just call it that. His perfect sufficiency. Notice just the first few words of verse 1. We have such an high priest. We have this kind of high priest. What does that remind you of? Something, it wasn't last week, but the week before. It reminds you at the end of chapter 7. Look at verse 22 of chapter 7. What does he say there? Or where is it? Verse 26, rather. Look at verse 26. For this is the kind of high priest we need. And it's, again, it's something similar to what you have in chapter 8, verse 1. We have this kind of high priest. This is the high priest we need. And he says, the high priest, you got it. And as we said a couple weeks ago, all of this points to what? The goodness of God. You needed a high priest, so God gave you a high priest. He gave you his son. And remember what he says back in chapter 7, verse 26. He's what? Holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. That's the kind of high priest you need. I mean, if you don't have him, what other high priest do you have? You have high priests from that old covenant through the line of Levi, and ultimately from the high priest with the line of Aaron, but they're just men. Remember in the old covenant, that all the laws that they had to do before they could even offer a sacrifice. They had to go through the washings. They had to make a sacrifice for themselves. In other words, they're sinners just like you. That's not the kind of high priest you need. Jesus's sufficiency is perfect. And that's the point there. We have such a high priest. Secondly, Jesus is a better mediator because of his finished work. Just three words there. Sat, he who sat down. Now he's contrasting this with the Levitical priests, because they stood up all day long. They sacrificed all day long. With Jesus, once for all, sitting down. That sounds better. Where is he? He's in the heavens, sitting down at the right hand of the Father. What does that point to? The fact that he's seating. His work is what? His work is complete. There were no chairs in the Old Testament's tabernacle. You ever think about that? There was a lot in the tabernacle. And maybe next week we'll come back and look at that, because I do think it would be helpful just to see the glory of the true tabernacle by contrasting it with the old tabernacle. So maybe next week we'll go back to Exodus 25 and I'll walk you through, you know, the courtyard and the altar and the holy place with the showbread and all the furniture that's in the tabernacle and how it does point to Christ. But of all the furniture in the tabernacle, there was no chair. As he went in, he did his work, and he came out. It was never finished. He had to do it once a year going into the Holy of Holies, right? But with Jesus, it's a finished work. That's why he's a better mediator. Thirdly, as you can see, this is, again, in verse 1, Jesus is a better mediator because he is at the right hand of the throne of the majesty. So we can point to his what? His coronation. He's a king priest. Yes, he's a priest, but he's a king priest. Point here is that Jesus is not seated, but where is he seated? He is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty. That points to his person, points to his work. He is seated on the throne in heaven and at the right hand of the Father. You'll remember, by the way, how the whole book of Hebrews opens with that. You go back to Hebrews chapter 1. Long ago, God spoke to the fathers by the prophets at different times and in different ways. In these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. God has appointed him heir of all things and made the universe through him. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and exact expression of his nature, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After making purification for sin, dealt with sin, he sat down. I mean, obviously he was raised from the dead and ascended and exalted. And then he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. That's the kind of priest you need. You need one that's perfectly sufficient, that the work is finished, that he is not just a priest, but a king priest, that he's coronated. Even all the times that he's quoted Psalm 110 back in chapter 6 and chapter 7, remember Psalm 110, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. Sit till it's done. Sit till all the enemies come under your feet, until the consummation. And then fourthly, Jesus is a better mediator because of his supreme exaltation. And this is just echoing where he is again. Where is he? He's seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty. And where is the throne of the majesty? It's where? It's in the heavens. I mean, this takes us back to chapter 4, verse 14, where it's just this small little comment that you might read and overlook it, the importance, but it says that Jesus passed through the heavens. Remember that? I mean, you can turn and look at there. In Hebrews 4, 14, it says that Jesus passed through the heavens. Well, of course he did, but what's the significance of that? Well, remember, the high priest passed through the veil into where? The Holy of Holies. That's the parallel. Just as the high priest passed through the veil into the Holy of Holies to bring the sacrifice into the presence of God. See, if God was happy about that, satisfied with that sacrifice, well, Jesus took his own blood, passed through the heavens into the very presence of God and offered his own blood, and God obviously was satisfied with it because he's exalted. The name above all names. Where's God? Let's start there. Where's God? God is in heaven. Where's Jesus? Jesus is in heaven. And where does he minister as a king priest? Well, he ministers in heaven as well. That sounds like a better deal than whatever you had in the old covenant, because all of that was on earth. I mean, just take verse 1. Can you conceive of a high priest who is perfectly sufficient ministering on the basis of a covenant that cannot change hearts? I can. Could a priest who has finished his work minister from a covenant that could finish nothing? Can we conceive of a king priest in the highest heaven being limited by an old covenant that made nothing perfect? So yes, Jesus is a king priest. He is more superior than Aaron, more superior than Melchizedek. But with that, you need a new what? Not just a new priesthood, you need a new covenant. And that's his point here. The new covenant is more superior than the old covenant. Why? Because it is ministered by a better mediator. This is why we make a fuss about Jesus. This is why we sing songs about Jesus. This is why we want to tell people about Jesus, because there is no other name under heaven given to men by which they may be saved. And what's the goal of salvation? Communion with God. Did you know anything about that? Do you know anything about communion with God? Well, the only way you're going to have communion with God is through his Son, Jesus Christ. We'll stop there for this morning. And we'll come back next week and we'll talk about that he ministers in a better place with a better sacrifice and with better promises. This is all better, better, better. So yeah, a lot of meat, a lot of theology, a lot of Christology, but the practical point of all of it is we get access to God and have communion with him, and in his presence is fullness of what? Joy. Sounds like a deal. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our time this morning that we could just contemplate and meditate on your goodness and the superiority of Christ. We thank you that you saved us. We did not save ourselves. We can't save ourselves. That the gospel is free to those who believe. And Lord, if there are any here this morning who do not believe, who do not know you, that today would be the day of salvation, that they would see their need of a Savior, that they do not want to fall in the hands of a living God, an angry God, without their sins washed and cleansed, without their sins being forgiven. So may they look to Christ as we look to Christ and are thankful for him. We ask all of these things in his name. Amen.